And I am so pleased to be with you today and to have the chance to introduce our keynote speaker, Vincent Chan. He is a law professor in the Department of Applied English in Minchuan University. And he also, he has been, you know, with us, he has been involved with the FET program for a long time. Yeah. So, and he also has a very well knowledge about how English language education is implemented in Taiwan. So please join me in welcoming Professor Chan.
Okay, so this is my welcome message to you all. Okay, 欢迎到台湾来. That's the Chinese for welcome to Taiwan. Okay, I heard that many of you have been here for some time, so you're familiar with that expression. And for the old timer. Oh, sorry. This is for the newcomer. I heard that six of you are newcomers.
Yeah.
Okay. So
brand new.
祝你在台湾平安顺利. Wishing you. Okay. And then 平安顺利 meaning safe and smooth or pleasant stay in Taiwan. Okay, so this is the underlying part. And you notice that this 平安顺利 occurs in this position before in Taiwan, right? Okay? And then for the old timers, okay, 感谢你. Thank you for staying in Taiwan, 留在台湾, 坐育英才. Okay? So, 坐育英才. Two meanings. Okay? Talent. Nurturing talent in Taiwan. Okay? And then the other one, ambiguous, okay, to help promote in Thai, meaning those who are, who can speak English quite well. These are the special people, well versed in using English as a language to communicate. So, but you notice here, this time, the last four words, 坐育英才, occurs at the end, unlike this one here. Yeah. Anyone who can figure out why this is the case?
Is it because there's not a preposition? Preposition goes at the end?
Okay. See, now you're talking, right? Okay, this is the prepositional phrase in Taiwan. And then this is like an object for wishing you something, that something is safe and peace. Okay? But then here, see, more or less the same position in Chinese, but then here it turns out to be infinitive. It's like an infinitive phrase. So I'm underlining these parts just to tell you that for the newcomers who don't know anything about Chinese, you see on the surface words which occur in the same position, but then they serve different functions. Okay, so the same thing with our kids learning English. Something you consider very easy, for you probably it would take years. Like when I was studying for my PhD in Florida, I taught Chinese, and it's really very difficult to teach things like this to the student, unless they read very extensively. Otherwise, things like this would be very, very okay, so my best wishes to you all, the newcomers, the old timers, okay? So a very pleasant stay here. And this is my outline. I'll start with the importance of English here and what we have done over the years to help promote the proficiency of our Taiwanese learners, okay? And I'll focus on three things. Focusing basically on the primary level, because this is what most of you will be focusing on, the primary level, Some of you would go to junior high or the so-called middle schools, okay? But most of you would focus on primary English education. Okay, so this is how important English is, right? These are quotes from famous scholars saying that English is important and there are more and more people learning English. And the third one here says that we now have this abbreviation ELF. English is a lingua franca. Okay. And then for people whose native language is not English, somehow they would try to learn how to say things right in English in order to communicate with people who don't share the same mother tongue with them. So this is how important English is. It's a lingua franca, a means of communication. Okay? And then, so what has Taiwan done over the years? Okay, seeing the importance of English globally. Okay? And so here are some of the things that we have done. Okay? So for example, back in March 2002, Chen Xuebian, former president, okay, he proposed that okay, we should promote the status of English from the most important foreign language to second official language, like in Singapore. Okay? And then following his instruction, so Premier Liu Xiaoqun announced back in 2003, saying that English will become a quasi-official language in 8 to 10 years. That was back in 2003, right? It's 2017 now. You ask Chinese teachers, local teachers here, has anything changed? They will tell you nothing got changed. Okay? Because there are some very difficult measures.
How long have foreigners been coming to Taiwan to teach? When did that first start?
You mean?
Like when? What year were foreigners first starting to come to Taiwan to teach English?
Oh, you mean? This program was about 12 years ago?
12, right. The first one was established by
Historically, it would have been at the turn of the century in the early 1900s.
Yeah.
Yeah, they started coming in with the Japanese.
Yeah, we followed the example, the success of Japan and Korea, South Korea. So we had officials going there and to learn about their success.
Because everything was made in Taiwan in the 90s mostly, and late 80s, I guess. So you would have needed a strong English communication then.
Actually, you can survive without English here. That's the problem. It's the problem. English education. Yeah. In Singapore, it's a different story. But then in Taiwan, actually, without English, you can manage to count. So that makes the biggest difference here.
So the Bushiban system, when did that come about?
Bushiban, that has a long history. When I was...
But with English?
Oh, with English. You mean for studying English as a school subject?
Yes.
The cram school English teaching.
Okay.
Jane, when did that start?
I'm 64 years old now. When I was a senior high school student, a long time ago, there was this cram schools everywhere teaching English as an academic subject. It's for taking tests.
Yes.
Yeah, not for everyday life.
Was it with a foreign English teacher?
No. Back then, no.
So I think the question was, when did foreign English teachers start teaching
Bushibans?
Nowadays you have more foreign English teachers, but then in my time, very, very few.
Because they must have changed the law to let foreign English teachers have a work permit and an ARC, right?
That's about 15 years. 15 years in history.
Okay. 15 years? Yeah. My friend, he came to Taiwan 35 years ago.
Probably that was not in the school context.
Yeah.
No, that was in the university.
Yeah.
University?
Yeah. University professors, yes, that was long ago.
Right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, so, good, okay. So, I was talking about this very noble goal to achieve, but then somehow, as we will see why this project failed, okay? But then, we also, at the time, we had this project called Challenge 2008, and then one of the major goals was to make sure that all citizens achieve this minimum standard of English proficiency. But again, that failed also. Very sadly, okay?
Do you know why it failed? Sorry, this is what you're going to ask me. Do you know why?
Yeah, I will come to that in a minute. Okay. So we even have very strong incentives provided. Okay. So like, if you can prove that your English proficiency has achieved certain level, when you're trying to get your promotion, you can get bonus points. But not for Japanese proficiency. See, this is very strong incentive. Okay. And then, for the educational system, we started back in 2001, starting at fifth grade, because as you will see, they are fascinated by this, the earlier the better myths, okay? And then so when Ma Ying-jeou, again, former president, when he took office, he made this point that English proficiency must be assessed national incentives for civil servants. So again, these were incentives, okay? And recently, we have Mayor Lai in Tainan City. He's a very, very powerful candidate for the next presidency. And he's making this point that English is very important, so let's have English as the second official language in Tainan City. This has been going on for 2 years. Yeah, but that met with some challenges. So one of the city councilmen was saying, kids can't even speak their native language, Southern or Hakka. Why bother to talk about learning English as a second foreign language? So again, very high goals. Okay? So as you can see, I have shown you many efforts, measures taken, okay, to make sure that English proficiency is promoted here in Taiwan. But as I hinted to you that there's still room for improvement. Yes. Okay, when we ask people, teachers, people on the street, are you satisfied? Do you find the outcomes of Taiwan's ELT satisfactory, given 4 choices? Which one is the most popular choice?
Well, yes and no.
Very few say this. These two. Very few. Most of them will focus. Most of them focus on unsatisfactory. Okay. And why? Okay. So they will point to evidence, okay? Like we have this comprehensive exam. This is the exam required for junior high graduates, ninth graders who want to get into the senior high 10th grade. If they want to get admitted to the better schools, they would have to prove that they have high proficiency in all subjects. But then, in terms of the English subject, for 4 years in a row, you find that about 33% failing in the English subject. So that tells you why people are not quite satisfactory. Of course, not just this, okay? Well, these are just a slide showing you that, see, this is English. This is the two Chinese words you need to know. English, okay? This is woven with the Chinese, English, math, social science, natural sciences. Okay. So, English. 33.73, failing to meet the standard.
So this was the first year comprehensive exam was held. Second year, 73, okay? We are close kin to math. These two subjects are the killers, okay? And then again, this was last year, 31.54. And this year, 30.62. We have about 30% failure in this English subject.
Yes.
Have schools tried using what you call intercurricular English with other subjects? Have they tried including that in order to increase comprehension levels?
Oh, not for now. But then in the new curriculum guidelines, we have room, flexibility for that. But not for now. For now, when you teach English, you teach English only. Not English through PE, English through social science, and things like that.
But so
in the next 2 years, starting from 2 years from now, yes. But then again, you see the gap. We have some better ones, but then still we have these people, easily failing the comprehensive exam. Okay? So back to the question you were asking, why? Okay? Are our teachers, are our students to blame? If you have been here for some years, you know that our students are very hardworking. They want to do better in terms of their English learning. But if students are not the main factor, or the teachers to blame, still, our teachers are hardworking too, right? And then they always complain that they don't have time to teach what they want to teach. So they do their part too. So what's the problem? The students are doing their part, the teachers are doing their part. So what?
The book.
The book? Okay, textbook. What's your impression about the textbook?
I haven't seen a public school's school book, but I know that there's definitely an emphasis on reading and writing, which kind of gets in the way and leaves a lot of Taiwanese as they get older, unable to read and write, but just afraid to talk and also not to listen. So yeah, just a more comprehensive textbook would be like that inclusive reading and
talking. Textbooks? Okay. Textbook actually for most students, textbooks are the only resource
That's
for
right.
them to
we need more like real life practice.
Right. Okay, so lots of things, yeah.
I feel that it's cool. My testing system. Everything.
Testing system
is this it's all about it's all about the score. Whether I give them a spelling test of 10 words, or whether if I give them a comprehensive speaking listening test, the parents don't care. They just want how much was it and why is it not answered. So for me, that is what killed. They have to be assessed in a math way, not in an English way.
Yeah. So, the test culture.
It's just from a short-term memory. It doesn't help you long term.
Yeah.
It's just the testing system currently just helps you short term memory.
You say students are hardworking. It's my experience. That's generally true here, but also the parents are hardworking. Parents are not really spending, in my school that I taught at, parents were not devoting time to students, to their kids at home, making sure they were doing their work, watching them. I didn't give homework. We had homework clubs, but because I was not allowed to actually give homework because they weren't doing it. They weren't going to do it, and it would just create a lower grade for them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I would say two things.
Yeah.
One, let them think about what they want to do and use English to do it.
Okay.
And that could be researching things. Or thinking of a question about a topic and then try to find out more. Or it could be doing some kind of activity, like if they're really sporty, like it was mentioned earlier, like crossing the disciplines. I think that's really important. The other thing is with English, if you're going to teach reading and writing, of course it's essential, but reading stories, and I really enjoy reading,
from pleasure. Yeah. It's like, that's how I learned English when I was a kid. Right. I love reading those. And the other thing is writing stories and poems and plays and like creativity. Because again, when I was a kid, I loved doing that so much. And that was like the only reason I got good at English.
The difference is, like, you're a native speaker though. And so we speak before we read and before we write. You know, we speak for a long time. So we're able to put two and two together by the time it comes that we can read it, right?
Right.
But when you're learning it fresh from, like, straight off the bat, then you've got all this kind of content coming at you, but a lot of it you don't understand, you don't know the meaning of the talking side of the language.
That's true. It's difficult. If you can get by with Mandarin in your life, and you can travel and you can use your Mandarin to help you in your life, it's very difficult to find a need for English. We see it in Russia. Russians very seldom speak English well. They don't need to. They can go to Uzbekistan, Kazakhstan, everywhere, Turkmenistan, and the language there, lingua franca, is Russian. So it's big languages have a harder time learning other languages.
But what Patrick said about the activity, like, the most success I've ever had is with the kids getting in the morning to learn it, is through activities, through integrated cutting classroom.
The reason I mentioned earlier, if you think subject, interdisciplinary is what we call it in middle school education. By creating interdisciplinary subjects, by mixing math with English or mixing English with history, you're able to get a more comprehensive understanding of the topic. And even through like vocational activity-based stuff, I was teaching technology over in Bloomington Junior High School, where I'm from, and I taught the basis of technology, technological conversation through English and through comprehension studies. And so by mixing the different topics, I think it would help increase it, especially if you have students that are more interested in, let's say a student wants to study history. If you mix historical topics with English, they'll be able to understand it and pick it up more. If a student really wants to become an airplane pilot, you can teach them about the different things that you do on an airplane through vocational studies in English.
Yeah, so students' needs. So that content and language integrated. Clear. Content and language integrated.
I think another thing from this family and test board that you're talking about is there's no continuity or communication between the elementary school and junior high curriculum. So when they leave elementary school, it has nothing to do with what they're going to learn or be tested on in junior high school. So they get there and you're testing them on things they should have learned or you want them to know. They don't have that, the building blocks.
Well, another way of putting it is like for the primary school teaching of English, we encourage this fun, relaxed way of learning. But when you get to junior high, that's an entirely different story. Lots of tests and the score counts.
Did it interchange?
Yeah.
But if that's the case, then why is the elementary school and the junior high, maybe the teachers talking or the curriculum?
Okay, we are now encouraging, so we have been promoting this dialogue between primary and secondary teachers so that there will be more efficient communication between the two.
I heard several examples of strategies that I've used. I have quantitative results from a year when I taught at a rural school in Jiaofen. And what I used was the scaffolding. We introduced and we use it again, the vocabulary. We also use communicative, where the vocabulary that we went over in class at the end of the chapter, the students had to come up with their own play, their own production using that, and they had to do that for every single chapter in that, every single lesson in that chapter. And at the end of the chapter, they had to use all the vocabulary and create a new play using all three lessons. And so at the end of that school year, I was hired to bring up their test scores from the standardized test. The average increase was 12%.
Wow, that's great.
It was a big thing in the community. I was like, oh my God, what? but it was a combination of everything. It was the scaffolding, it was the communicative, and also it was confidence building, because
at the beginning of every section, I would tell them what they were going to do at the end of the, by the end of the semester or the quarter. And I said, you're going to do a book report. No, we can't write a book report. No, that's too hard. Or you're going to create different lessons. And to let them know what the goal was. And then at the end, when they were doing it, and it was, they were having fun, they were talking, they were laughing, I said, remember back when you said you couldn't do this? They were like, oh my God, I couldn't do this, I'm doing this. And they would be so surprised at how much they advanced. I would set the target at the beginning, and we would just do, okay, here's one spoonful, here's another spoonful, here's another spoonful, look, you've eaten the whole bowl.
Thank you. Oh, for me, actually, I heard three important words in what you just said. One is use, right? So when they have to use English, that's a very different concept. Lots of kids in Taiwan, they study English for tests. They don't study English for use of English. So that's one major difference. The other one is you recycle. You're making things more practical in terms of the learning of English words and phrases. And the third thing is confidence building. See, the more they do it, good project or whatever, they kind of get the interest element, they get this confidence building thing. So actually, the reason for not, see, this is from the executive again, okay? We have this promoting English proficiency project, and the first thing they mention is we are poor in actual use of English in daily life and workplace. So back to what you were saying, using language is different from learning English to take tests. That's the most important difference. Okay, for successful learners, actually, they will think in terms of how I use this word to make a sentence, to communicate. But then for the less successful learners, they'll say, how do I score better in terms of studying these words and phrases? That's a very different mindset. Okay. So sometimes we here, we tend to compare Taiwanese learners with EU learners. Okay. And then for me, okay, actually learning English or mastering the English language is as easy as NPC for EU learners. But for Taiwanese learners, it's like weak. Very, very difficult, okay? And actually, this has nothing to do with intelligence on my part, okay? See, sometimes I'll tell them, for those teachers who are feeling very frustrated because of your hard work, and then pay off, I told them, don't get discouraged because we belong to different language families. For the EU learners, English is easy because English doesn't have a lot of complications. See, we don't see in a lot of EU languages, you have agreement between the singular or the masculine noun or adjectives to go with it. English doesn't have that. English has only ed, es, ing, nothing else. So for them to learn English is very easy, okay? But how about Taiwanese learners? That's an entirely different language, okay? So the mother tongue factor, a lot of research have shown that if your mother tongue is not similar with the target language, you're going to have lots of difficulties. And this is some of the things that I'm telling the teachers who feel very frustrated from the teaching process. It's not the students to blame. It's not you to blame. Sometimes you have to think about whether you are giving the student the right thing at the right moment in the right amount, okay? So for Mandarin Chinese, it's a sign of Tibetan language.